Cool. To the burning bush and his calling from God can help us react to our calling and the different ways we can do that. But first, we're going to play a fun game. It's really fun. How many of you guys have played Headbands?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is like Headbands, but since we're talking about calling, these are all like real jobs that people have. And what's going to happen is you guys are going to close your eyes. And I'm going to go around and tape one on each of your foreheads. And then you're going to open your eyes, and we're going to go around, and you're each going to guess what profession slash calling is on your forehead. Okay, close your eyes.
Am I a dentist?
No, there's nothing on your head yet. Okay, close your eyes.
Yes,
how do you know?
Can I be the dentist?
Dentist. I'm trying not to take your hair.
Is there a pastor that better be?
These are all super weird jobs.
How am I supposed to know a weird job?
Oh, no, John, we're going to give you hints.
I rubbed my eyes too much, and now it's blurry.
I am a chiropractor.
I'm sorry.
I'm, like, scared that
she's
going to slap it off.
I'm not going to do it.
Real thing?
Yes.
Oh, good. Yeah, it's not sitting, but it's
standing.
Yes.
that you pay someone for.
Yeah.
Not out of job.
27 dresses.
Not out, but. So you have the two words.
Stand-in.
Okay. Yeah. I am for tree. She.
In a wedding.
Well, I am for tree.
A woman for
her wedding. For her wedding.
For a wedding, a ceremony.
Oh, girl in a wedding.
I don't know what you are for
a wedding. 27 dresses. Not the maid of honor, but the...
By the altar.
Not the 12 girls that always
stand. It's not a groomsman, but a...
Stand-in bridesmaid.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, I know this job. Okay.
Oh, you have a weird job, man.
That's not that bad, I guess.
Money.
Right?
Yeah.
Money.
Metal change. Money.
Like coins?
Yeah. And cleaning. Coin cleaner. Not
nail.
What's
this, nail?
Nail
and
polisher.
Yes.
Yes.
Coin polisher.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Guys, you guys are doing so great. I'm going to do terrible.
Okay.
Okay.
So it's like a bike.
Okay.
But not
one
less than two wheels.
Okay. Is it like, oh my gosh, what's that called?
Oh my gosh.
It's called the unicycle.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yes. So a really intense one.
Yeah.
A really intense one.
Yeah.
Una.
So, X is three. those are all silly things that, like, probably none of us have thought about being, except apparently a panda cuddler and a dentist, which is kind of close to horse dentist. But each of us, like, we're obviously in college, we have majors, so we each have, like, our own, like, idea of what we want to do and our own sense of calling. For some of us, it might be, like, super specific, like, I know I want to do this, this, and this. For others, it might just be, like, a general, like, this is the direction that I want to go in. But either way it is, it's really easy to question our calling and to kind of be like, well, is this really, like, what I'm supposed to be doing? So we're going to look at Exodus 3, 2-4-12 tonight. We're going to look at how Moses reacted to his calling. So we're just going to start by reading all of it. So if you guys want to turn there. Kind of the three big questions that I want you guys to look at as we read it, just as an overview for the first time. Moses responds to the burning bush with three questions. So first, he asks God, like, who am I to do this? Like, what qualifies me? And then he asks God, like, who are you? Like, who am I supposed to tell the people that you are? And then he says, what if the people don't believe me? So, we're going to just split this up, and each person read, like, 10 verses. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Allie, do you want to start?
Oh, sure.
How many am I reading?
10.
All right.
Now Moses was tending the flock of Jericho, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said to him, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to the rescue, to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt.
Thanks. But Moses said to God, where am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. Go, assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you out of the misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a three-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go.
Jimmy, do you want to?
Sure. 21:8.
And I will give this people favor on the side of the Egyptians, and when you go, you shall not go empty. But each woman shall ask of her neighbor, and any woman who lives in her house, for silver and gold jewelry, and for clothing. You shall put them on your sons and on your daughters, so you shall plunder the Egyptians. Then Moses answered, but behold, they will not believe you or listen to your voice, for they will say, the Lord did not appear to you. The Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? He said, a staff. And he said, throw it on the ground. So he threw it on the ground, and it became a serpent. Then Moses ran from it. But the Lord said to Moses, put out your hand and catch it by the tail. So he put out his hand and caught it. That they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Again, the Lord said to him, put your hand inside your cloak. Then he put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous like snow. Then God said, put your hand back inside your cloak. So he put his hand back inside his cloak, and when he took it out, behold, it was restored like the rest of his flesh. If they will not believe you, to the first sign, they may believe the latter sign.
If they do not believe these two signs or listen to you, take some water from the Nile and pour it onto the dry ground. The water you take from the river will become blood on the ground. Moses said to the Lord, pardon your servant, Lord. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. The Lord said to him, who gave human beings their mouth? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go. I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. But Moses?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're good.
Thanks.
But yeah, it was pretty obvious in this that Moses was called to speak to Pharaoh on behalf of his people. So can you guys think of any times in your life that you've had a pretty clear calling and would you be willing to share some of those? Can you think of like a time in your life where you have like a pretty clear calling from God? So like for example, when I was at Bowling Green, I felt pretty strongly that God was calling me to leave and like transfer into full-time ministry.
Sorry.
Okay.
I don't remember when it happened, but I was driving in my car, and that's when I like to do a lot of my thinking because there's nothing else to do. So I was driving, and I just kind of thought about my brother and how everyone's like, oh, Steven's just so great because he's saving so many souls because he's in youth ministry. Mm-hmm. And it's like, but nobody really cares about what I'm doing. And I was just thinking, and I was like, you know what Steven needs to do? He needs to talk to people who are dying because they would be a lot more interested in coming to Christ because they're dying and they don't really have much to lose. So I feel like that would be a good place to start. And I was like, wait, why does Steven have to do that? Why can't I do that since I'm going into the health field? And I was like, I need to do that. I need to do hospice.
Yeah,
so that was my calling.
That's cool. That's a really cool realization. Ashley, what were you
going to
share?
I was just coming here, and like I've had like pretty obvious signs while making like my decisions that this is exactly the place I need to be.
Mm-hmm. Like signs of affirmation.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
I just remember when I was like how I feel. Had a guest speaker who was talking about missions, and like, I'm not going into missions or anything, but I don't know why. I just like, it was really clear to me because he was telling us about how they reach the people in the other countries and like the different ways they would do that, and like how they would show the Jesus film in the different language, and like the way he would just describe how the kids would cry when his daughter would talk, and like then how happy and rich he had.
first part was this passage, actually, at my youth retreat. I realized that God was calling me to somewhere farther than what I wanted, but also that, like, I felt a peace about dying for him, so that was a really weird calling and realization. But then that summer, I went to Nicaragua, and I had been sick, like, all day. I was like, God, like, why did you send me here if I was going to get sick? And then, like, that afternoon, I was sitting in the school room, and I just felt this, like, calling breeze come through the window, and, like, it was God being, like, it's okay, like, this is where I want you, and I just felt at peace. And, like, I haven't felt that at peace in a very, very long time. So, I just felt that was what I was supposed to do.
So I kind of said earlier about how we're going to move through the three objections that Moses had. So kind of him saying, who am I to be called? Who are you? Like, who am I supposed to tell them that you are? And what if people, like, don't believe me? And so we're going to focus on the first objection that Moses has first. Wow, imagine that. but a little bit of background before we go into that. Moses, he was born when all of the baby boys were being killed. And so his mom put him in a basket, sent him down the river. I see a lot of you nodding with the story. And so Pharaoh's daughter found him, and he grew up in Pharaoh's court. But then he saw one of the Egyptians beating up one of the Hebrews, his people. And he got really angry and killed the Egyptian. And he thought nobody saw it, but someone did see it. And so then he got called out, and he ran away to Midian, and then he was just a Midianite shepherd for, like, 40 years. And so it was after that 40-year period that God appeared to him in the burning bush. And so at this point, like, he kind of had every right to be like, who am I? Like, I'm just a shepherd. Like, I'm a fugitive from Egypt. I killed someone there, and so I fled. Like, why are you calling me to do this? And so, I'm going to read Exodus 3:11-2 again. Jess, do you want to read that for me?
Sure. Exodus 3:11-2.
12, sorry.
Okay.
I said 2, but 12 was backwards. Yeah, my bad.
I definitely didn't catch that.
Yes,
but Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you. I who have sent you, when you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain.
So, God's response. Can someone tell me what God's response was?
He said, don't worry about it. I got you.
Yeah, I'll be with you, right?
I will be with you. I said, that's all that matters.
Mm-hmm. So, I think that it's really easy sometimes to forget that, like, God is with us all the time. And there's that saying that it says, if you're not as close to God today as you were yesterday, guess who moved? And I think that's really true, because whenever we question, like, who we are, we kind of forget that it doesn't matter who we are. Like, God is with us, and we're to be leaning into him. And so I have an activity for us to do. I'm going to pass out the papers. Pass them out, and then I'll explain it. Just go ahead and take one. So also, I think it's really important, going back to 3:12, at the end it says, you will worship God on this mountain. And I think when we think about worshiping, we think about being in the presence of God and God being with us. But I also think that it's really easy to just kind of worship and sing songs and just kind of be there saying the words but not actually feeling it. And so...
we can share.
Okay, or there's a notebook right there if you want to. But anyway, I think there's a sense of the difference between worshiping, like, and just having God there and being with God. And so with these two boxes, I want in the top box, I want for you guys to draw a picture of just two people, any two people. It can be yourself and someone else, or two completely random people. but I want it to be just like people who are in a room together, not really interacting, kind of like how you would worship and just say the words. Like, they're not really interacting, they can be doing two separate activities, they're just kind of both existing in the same space. And then the bottom box is going to be two people, like, interacting, like, in relationship with each other and really engaging and, like, being in one another's presence. So for those of you that are done, do you want to start sharing what the two different pictures are? You don't have to show the picture, you can just explain what you drew. Just explain how the two pictures look different. Ashley?
Okay. So my first picture, I drew me and Linnea doing our homework on our bed, not talking because we're studious and doing our homework. And then here's us having a deep roommate conversation because we love each other.
Those two things look very different. You're doing two different tasks.
Yeah.
The first one.
Not talking to each other. And then the second one, we're engaging with each other.
We're being studious, that's what got me.
Yeah. But I have like one person on the phone, like taking orders, and another one like running the drive-through, and like you're not talking to each other. You're just like apart, but you're like in the same vicinity. You don't really care about each other. But then I have it where we're slicing meat and we're having fun and we're like talking and like enjoying our day. And yes, music videos.
No, no. Okay.
The bottom one, they're sharing a plate of spaghetti. Oh, I love spaghetti. Oh,
so I was going to do a glass of wine, but I didn't.
I know.
Okay, does anyone else want to share what they wrote?
Yes,
I meant Drew.
Hold on. This is a masterpiece.
Okay.
Megan, what'd you draw?
Mm-hmm.
Going.
No, she's finished.
She's finishing up.
Leia's going.
What?
Yeah!
You're right, Ruby. I'm sorry.
I am hurt.
I'm sorry. I literally thought about writing the same exact thing as you did.
What did you end up doing?
All I just did is like two people sitting, one playing cards by themselves, the other one's reading.
Me and you?
Yeah. Do you want to play cards or read?
Play cards.
Okay, so Ashley's playing cards and I'm reading, and then we end up playing cards together.
Yeah. Wait, what are you playing?
I mean, the first one they're playing solitaire because they're alone.
Yeah.
The second time.
We're playing Egyptian Masker.
There we go.
Oh
yeah.
You know what's going on.
Okay.
What's up, details?
Wow.
Alright. And this one is yelling at the TV. And then. So there's the TV on, and then in the back, this person is on their phone. The technology gets in the way of everything. So, and so they're just kind of just. And then those are feedback chairs, just so you know. And then this one down here, they're sitting in. We're sitting in the feedback chairs and playing the board game.
Wow.
I'm sorry. I took
the boom.
I think you guys gave really good examples of the difference between being apart from someone and interacting with someone. And so it's basically a very good illustration of what it's like to make sure that we're engaging with God and being in relationship with Him instead of sitting on our phone, things like that. So we're going to move on to the second objection that Moses had now. So the second objection he had was that he wanted to know more of who God is. So Megan, would you like to read Exodus 3:13-14 for me?
Yeah, Megan. Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your father has sent me to you,' and they ask, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell him?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you."
So God responds with, "I am who I am." I think it's such a simple but yet all-encompassing definition. Like, he is whoever he wants to be. And I think it's vague, but vague on purpose. It gives God kind of the freedom to be whatever he wants to be. Like, obviously he's sovereign, can do whatever he wants. So, also, interestingly, this can be translated to, "I will be what I will be." And so, I think that's interesting because he promises that he will be there. Like, his presence is promised. What we just talked about, his presence is promised. But we don't necessarily know in what way. Like, we don't know his plans. We know we'll be there, but we don't know what he's going to do. Now we're going to learn about how important it is to know about God so that we can tell others. Because I think too often our faith just amounts to, I don't know, it's God, I believe in God. And so we have a crossword, and for this, it's going to be a little competition. So you compare up. Jamie, you look mad about anything to look up the scripture, but there are lists of scripture, and then you have to
use your Bible.
Use your Bible and Bible, and put the name of the book in wherever it goes on that. But then, for the second part of it, you can use your phone and like Google the scripture if you can't find it. And I guess first place like gets a prize or something. It's probably just a high five. It's a high five for me.
What if there's not a number?
You can make a group of three. You can pair up yourself.
I'll do one.
Okay, you guys can just
No, the A would have to be here.
Exodus 4:1-12
believe me or listen to me. What if they say, the Lord never appeared to you? Then the Lord asked him, what is that in your hand? A shepherd's staff. Moses replied, throw it down on the ground, the Lord told him. So Moses threw down the staff, and it turned into a snake. Moses jumped back. Then the Lord told him, reach out and grab its tail. So Moses reached out and grabbed it, and it turned back into the shepherd's staff in his hand. Perform this sign, the Lord told him. Then they will believe that the Lord, the God of their ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, really has appeared to you. Then the Lord said to Moses, now put your hand inside your cloak. So Moses put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out again, his hand was as white as snow with a severe skin disease. Now put your hand back into your cloak, the Lord said. So Moses put his hand back in, and when he took it out again, it was as healthy as the rest of his body. The Lord said to Moses, if they do not believe you and are not convinced by the first miraculous sign, they will be convinced by the second sign. And if they don't believe you or listen to you even after these two signs, then take some water from the Nile River and pour it out on the dry ground. When you do, the water from the Nile will turn to blood on the ground. But Moses pleaded with the Lord, O Lord, I am not very good with words. I never have been, and I am not now, even though you have spoken to me. I get tongue-tied, and my words get tangled. Then the Lord asked Moses, who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether people speak or do not speak, hear or do not hear, see or do not see? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go. I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say.
So, I think whenever we're like, oh, how is this person going to feel about us? It's really important to remember that God has power and authority over all of it. He did all of these miracles and signs for Moses, and he does that in our own lives, but it's really easy to not be attentive to how God is working and how God is proving his faithfulness to us. So, this is our third and final activity. I'm going to pass it this way this time. Wow. Yeah. No! No! Okay. No. So, we are going to kind of work together and brainstorm a list of three different things. So, how we're going to talk about, like, God, you are so fill in the blank. I think a lot of times it's easy to just pray and ask God for things that we need, but also it's really important to pray to get to know God better. So, we're just going to help each other brainstorm a list of adjectives? Is that the English thing? Okay, yeah, adjectives! Adjectives! And then we're going to just kind of share ways that we're awed by God. So that might be specific things happen in our life, it might be like nature. And then we're going to talk about ways that God has been faithful to us. So we'll just start with the first one, and just kind of throw out some adjectives.
Are you doing this as a group?
Yeah. Just?
Am I ready to go?
You made a mark!
Sovereign?
Sovereign.
Personal.
kidding.
You could add a lot of letters to the beginning. You were so right.
Yeah.
Light. All
yeah.
Right.
Bright.
Mighty. Oh, mighty. That's a good one.
Where?
It's okay,
I'm fine.
Okay.
Is it,
okay.
Is it flying?
It will be no way.
It's okay.
It's
okay. You guys, I love you.
Loving, yeah. Forgiving.
Was loving the thing that?
No, that's a great one. Loving.
Forgiving. Merciful. Pursuing.
Was it whenever you like cater to someone because they're small and tiny and
nurturing?
Then you dumb it down, but I don't know how that. accommodating.
Accommodating.
Yeah. Move to the next one. I am in awe of nature.
Good night.
How do you say?
Love. That's so cute. I love it. So festive.
What's going on
here? Here.
I'm recording the one you said.
Babies.
Baby? It's miracle. Kind of goes together, baby and miracles, like just life in general. A lot of time worship leaves me in awe. has no anything else, we'll move to the last one. So this one says, you were faithful when... When you said...
When I was
faithful
when I think
a big one is, he's faithful when we're obedient. There's a lot of times, especially in my life, where I've been called to take risks and kind of step out onto unknown waters, but he's always faithful for me. Be respectful of your guys' time. So if nobody has anything else, we'll go ahead and wrap up that activity. Any last words? Okay, so it's so much easier to remember that God's going to be faithful when we remember all the ways he's been faithful before. So I encourage you guys to keep these lists, maybe expand on the bottom part with some personal things in your life, like things that you really need a God to work in and pull through, and ways that he did that. So, just going to close in prayer. Does anyone have any last minute thoughts that they've been dying to say this whole time but didn't get a chance to?
I like you. I wish I was a child now so that you were my
oh, I'm sorry. I can be your rival.
All right.
And your friend.
Yay! That was really loud. I'm so sorry.
Okay, I'm going to close this out. Okay. God, I thank you for bringing us all together. I thank you for how beautiful and unique these ladies are. God, I just thank you that you're present in their life, and I just thank you that you're working with them all the time, even if they're just kind of doing their own thing in the room or whether they're engaging with you. I just praise you that you're always there. God, I pray that as we go through life and just mature in our faith, that we're able to learn more about who you are and really increase our knowledge of you so that we can share that with other people. And God, I just thank you for all the ways that you act in our life and the power that you have over everything in our life. And I just pray that we never forget how faithful you are, that we can just walk alongside you. And I pray that by remembering all of these things, that we can just have the courage to really pursue the calling that you have for us wholeheartedly and fearlessly. We love you so much. Amen. Stop this video. Casually climbing on the counter.
Bye.